Today, I'm going to talk about the main troublemakers when it comes to communications, noises and losses. Now, we are familiar with the word noise from our everyday life and we all know how bad noise can be. But what do we mean by noise in radio comms? It's essentially the same thing as noise with sound waves, unwanted additional signal which mixes with a real signal and modifies it. So, for example, if you listen to your favorite song, the sound of the song is the wanted signal and your loud neighbors might be the noise source. Their sound disrupts the information flow from your favorite song and you can hear it well. Something very similar happens when we want to receive a certain signal and our system is noisy. You might wonder who makes this noise. In the case I imagined, our neighbors generate the noise, so in a similar way, a neighboring antenna can generate noises for you if the frequencies it uses are close to those you use. This type of noise is external interference and it can be dealt with by regulations on the bandwidth and spacing of antennas, but even if you eliminate it, there are of course other sources of noise. So, from basic thermodynamics, any system has a non-zero temperature, which is equivalent to saying that the particles in it are constantly moving. This movement itself generates noise known as thermal noise, or Nyquist-Johnson noise. This noise is proportional to the temperature but depends on many characteristics. Additionally, current arises as the flow of charge carriers, but these charge carriers, for example electrons, are all separate, so noise is generated as a result of them coming in discrete portions also. This is known as shot noise or Schottky noise. Two more sources of noise known as the flicker noise and burst noise appear in electronics. One of them is produced by resistance fluctuations, while the other one results from, we can say, bursts of trapped charge carriers. Before going into any details, there is one important distinction that we have to make, that between white noise and colored noise. Now, what we mean by white noise is noise whose density does not depend on the frequency. For example, the thermal noise is white. It is the same at kilohertz, megahertz, gigahertz, etc. So it does not depend on the frequency itself, only on the temperature. Some noises, however, are colored. What we mean by this is that they affect certain frequencies more and they may even be completely absent in others. The flicker noise is an example of such a noise. It becomes lower and lower for higher frequencies. On the plot you can see what I'm talking about. On the left you can see a typical white noise. It may fluctuate a lot, but its average is constant everywhere. While on the right you can see the other profile, and that is noise drop is 1 over the frequency. We won't go through all of these noises in detail here, but we will say a little more about the thermal noise. It turns out that it depends on the temperature, as the name suggests, and its power per unit bandwidth, so its power per hertz is given by a constant times the temperature in kelvins. This constant is known as Boltzmann's constant and it's a very small number, roughly 1.38 times 10 to the power of minus 23, so the noise per unit bandwidth may be very small even for high temperatures. This quantity is the average power, of course. There are small fluctuations all the time, but the statistical nature of the thermal noise makes it easy to give its average effect solely in terms of the resistant temperature. Now, the coupled noises, those who arise by external processes which are somehow affecting the input signal, are not so easy to evaluate. They are usually much more random and depend on many external elements. Coupled noise sources include the sun, others include antennas, cosmic rays in radiation, the environment itself, the ionosphere and the troposphere and even the Earth itself. All of these produce some electromagnetic waves which are highly random and they can enter the channel through one of the antenna lobes and cause external noise. And since it is very hard to estimate all of them separately and compute the total noise received, it's much easier to use an effective scheme. The idea is very simple. What if we could convert all of these noises to thermal noises? Of course, we can't physically do this, but we can define a hypothetical resistor which contains all of them. So instead of analyzing all the external noises and trying to compute all of their contributions, we simply model them as an additional resistor with effective temperature known as the antenna noise temperature. So, this antenna noise temperature is not a physical temperature, it's not the temperature you'd measure with a thermometer at the antenna, but it is the theoretical temperature at which the resistor would have to be to produce the same noise level as all of these noise sources together. So, just to give a simple example, suppose you are given antenna noise temperature at 300 kelvins. Now, 273 kelvins correspond to 0 degrees Celsius. So, this antenna noise temperature, if translated to physical temperature, would correspond to room temperature. What noise would it give us if we had 60 kHz channel? Using our formula for antenna noise per bandwidth and Boltzmann's constant, we get about 10 to the power of minus 21 watts per hertz. Now, if we multiply this by our bandwidth, which is 60 kHz, we get a total noise of about 0.24 femtowatts. Now, 1 femtowatt is 10 to the power of minus 15 watts, so this is indeed a very small quantity. We do not really know what powers we are dealing with yet, though, so in the next chapter we will see that this is not negligible and in many applications the power of the signal we are considering may be quite comparable to one of the noise. Now, something quite similar to the antenna noise temperature is the system temperature. Essentially, it's the same idea but considering the whole system, both transmitting and receiving ends. So, we model all of the noises in the system as arising from a single hypothetical resistor and we give the noise power in terms of this hypothetical temperature it would have. Naturally, we should consider the different noise sources in different directions and so this quantity will depend on our system configuration and our antenna pointing as well as generally random processes such as the cosmic emission, solar activity, etc. But generally, we can estimate this temperature and its value for a given application and this allows us to evaluate the noise we will have in our system. So, how can we include the noises mentioned and really evaluate out communication capabilities? One of the most important ratios we should consider is the so-called signal-to-noise or channel-to-noise ratio. Intuitively, it's clear that even if we have noises, if the signal is much stronger than the noises, we will be okay. So the noise power itself is not giving us any information about how good our channel is. But the ratio of the good signal with respect to this noise is. A very important result in this respect is the Shannon theorem. What it tells us is the maximum effective channel we can use given a certain signal-to-noise ratio and bandwidth. Now, Gaussian noise refers to the probability density with which the noise is distributed and it's not essential for our purposes. But the important part is that we have a limit of how much information we can transmit, which depends only on the bandwidth and the signal-to-noise ratio. Obviously, the larger this ratio is, the better it is for our communication system, and we will learn how to apply this concept and get a general result which characterizes our error rate. There are two more quantities which are very important and they will lead us to our desired error rate. These are the energy per bit and the noise spectral density. Now, the noise spectral density, denoted N, is a straightforward concept. It is simply the noise per unit bandwidth, so for white noise is just N divided by B. Also, remembering that power is energy over time, if we have digital transmission, the energy for each bit times the transmission speed, which is in bits per second, gives us exactly the power of the signal. Given these two quantities, we can rewrite the signal-to-noise ratio and also Shannon's theorem. As we will soon see, the quantity energy per bit to noise power spectral density ratio is the most relevant one in the case of digital modulation, since it is directly related to the bit error rate, as you can see on this plot. But to evaluate it, we first need to consider all the noises, in addition to the noises which we have in our system. We will learn how to compute the energy per bit to noise power spectral density in the next lesson, about link budget. And now we will continue with the list of the relevant noises and their relevance for this link.